I think when thinking about what makes a good story for the screen, we need to consider what film is. And film is a visual medium. So before the talkies, films with synchronized sound, they were silent. So stories were told through action, gestures, facial expression, and movement. And it uses film form, so the mise-en-scene, cinematography, editing, and sound to advance the narrative. So when thinking about what makes a good story for the screen, one of the things you have to think about is, can you tell your story through images? If you can easily picture your story, if you can easily picture your character's journey, then your idea is likely to be suitable for screen. So wherever possible, show rather than tell. And think about images carrying as much of the story, if not more, than dialogue.
Like, film and television gives you a depth of character in a very short space of time that other mediums can't. I think good screen stories allow you to get inside someone else's head and see the world how they see the world. For me, it's about being with that character and feeling for them and empathizing with them. I think the secret to a good story is that you tell it from the heart, that it comes from the heart.
So for me, anything that's told with bravery, I think, is appealing to me as a viewer, as well as a story that I can relate to and that I can see myself involved in some way, be that through the theme of it, the plot and story of it, or through the characters. And I think in particular, stories for screen are ones that embrace the visual side of the medium as well as the audio. You know, it's very easy for us to write a scene and overwrite the dialogue of it because we're really trying to make sure we get the idea of the scene across to the audience.
So the first thing, film's a visual medium. Is this a story that is going to be enhanced by a visual storytelling? If it's a story that really dwells in people's interiors, maybe that's actually a novel. So you need to think about the medium itself. Then you need to think about what is going to engage people. You need a story that involves change of some kind. We need to see people succeed or fail. A film that doesn't change much, it just may not work. You need that sort of forward momentum. A book you can put down and come back to, but a film is playing out in time and you want your audience to remain captive. So it has to be something that's going to hold us.
That's such a subjective question because I think that's really personal. And I think what makes a great story is something that's really important to you, and otherwise there's no point in telling it. And the moment that you have a story that you need to tell, then other people will need to see it and understand it and relate to it, and I think that's what makes a great story.
I think a great story is something that plays on your emotions and takes you on a journey. It can make you cry, make you laugh, just something that surprises you. And I think a great story is one that looks at the external conflicts and the internal conflicts. So that could be the world around us, like what's difficult and complex, how does it change? And also the internal conflicts of your character. How do they change from the beginning to the end? So you want to see that change.
I think the best kind of story is one that moves its audience. And that doesn't have to be to tears. It could be that you're moved to laughter or you're scared or that it changes your belief in something. I think a great story connects with its audience emotionally.
When I first start to develop an idea, I don't think I have a preferred format in mind. It's the idea that matters the most to me. But I do think as the idea starts to develop, it does naturally lean towards a preferred format, whether that was is short script or feature length script or TV episode. As an example, my first short, The Dump, I knew pretty early on that that was going to be a short film or a short script, and that was for a number of reasons. One, I wanted to set it over one day, And obviously one day it's not a long time in a film, and a short script suited that. It was also set in one location, which again lends itself to a shorter form. But also it was about recognizing my kind of limitations as a filmmaker. I'd never made a film before, so I certainly wasn't going to be given millions of dollars to go away and make a feature. And so I wrote something bearing in mind that I needed to make something that had a chance of being made. So I wrote something that had a good chance of being made. And so the dump was kind of grew out of that.
I think the amount of story that you have will determine what medium, what format you tell it in. So I often read short film scripts and go, whoa, that's a lot of story. That's way too much for this tiny film. But also I've written a feature film that had too much in it to be a feature even. So that then became a TV show. But I think when you're starting out, it's a good idea to try and tell it in as small a way as possible, as briefly as possible. What's the essence of your idea? I will try and start in the story as late as possible and come out of it as early as possible. And finding that moment in your story where something shifts, that the most important, most interesting bit to you, that could be an entire short film.
When thinking about whether a story is suitable for a particular format, I start thinking about things like, does the story have a closed ending? Does it have a beginning, middle, and end? Because if it doesn't have these things, it might be more suited to another format like television or a novel or theatre. Are the images just as important, if not more, than dialogue? Again, if not, then it might be suited to theatre or an episodic format.
Yeah, I consider a lot of things when assessing a story for a particular format. Often it's about the sort of the length of the story itself or how many characters are involved. Some things do definitely feel weighted towards more of a series where you can explore in-depth characters or worlds, whereas some things that are a more concise sort of tight storytelling environment could be better suited for a film.
I mean, filmmakers are really visual people, so when you read words, if they don't become images in your head immediately, then potentially it's not going to work. So the format that it takes usually forms itself really, really quickly, and you should trust those instincts and really go with them. And you can finesse it. You can create bigger pictures or firmer ideas, but really hold on to those instincts. It's really important. Like, you can even write those down. This is how I felt immediately, or this is the image that I saw, and go back to those a lot, because that's it's a very sort of guttural reaction to a story.
The great thing about making for the web is that the restrictions are much looser. There's much less censorship. There's less restriction on how long the episodes need to be. And you can actually find a niche audience quite easily, whereas on television or short films, you're restricted by, you know, potentially putting it in festivals or putting it on television, and you don't get the chance to just put it out globally, such as on YouTube, Instagram, or TikTok, which are three and obviously more very useful devices for us as makers. We can put our stuff out there, test it out, find an audience. We did that with Awkward Love and YouTube. And we've also done that more recently with a show called Millennial Jenny for Instagram, which is standalone episodes, 1 minute, using Instagram's restriction of 1 minute time limit, and it's found a wonderful audience globally.
The way I work out between a television series and a web series, there's not a lot of difference, to be honest. Money is a big one, not gonna lie. Do I think this has massive commercial appeal? I might try and push for the TV series. This is like a heart story, this is something I'm desperate to show, it's a little bit risque, I'm not sure of my audience, it's a bit more explorative, I will make it a web series. But saying that, I think you should, in terms of the series, make what you want and then figure out if it's got a home on in TV or the web. These days, Netflix, for example, everything is a web TV show. So it's big, the line isn't so clear.
When you're creating your own story, as I have done many times and my team have done many times, the inspiration for the story itself can come from anywhere. Whether that be seeing a person on the street and wondering what their story is, be it a scenario you've been in yourself and wanting to either tell the fully non-fictional side of that, or you want to make a little bit more of a story out of a scenario you've been in, or, you know, you've read a short film and you're inspired to tell a story similar. The inspiration can come from anywhere.
I think stories don't have to come from the environment around you, but I think the best stories are the ones that you have a personal connection to, that matter to you, that you care about, and that only you can tell. And part of that is where you come from, your upbringing, your place in the world, your family relationships. I think your voice and your unique perspective is what will make your story special.
I think the environment around you definitely has a huge part to play in where stories come from, but often they can just spark an idea that can open your imagination to bigger things. I love genre films, I love science fiction. A lot of those specifically don't come from my environment, but the humanity and the empathy and the heart of a story should always come from something that you recognise or would like to see.
I don't think stories necessarily come directly from the environment around you. For example, George Lucas wasn't living in a galaxy far, far away from here when he created Star Wars, but his story and his way of interpreting and creating that story would have come from the themes he was interested in, so spirituality and morality. And I think it's really, really important that you relate strongly to the theme that you are exploring in your story. And your understanding and interpretation of those themes will come from your worldview, your physical environment, your culture, your political ideologies, and your understanding of the world.
In terms of whether or not stories need to come from the environment around you, no, it's not a hard and fast rule, but having said that, all the stories that I've made so far have seemed to come from the environment around me. And I guess there's really obvious advantages in starting with stories that come from a world that you're comfortable with. Your knowledge of this world is obviously far greater, and therefore when you tell the story, your connection to the material is going to be that much more pronounced and deep. So when something's grounded in truth, that's a really important thing. Having said that, although the seed for the idea often comes from the world around you, it's the seed. And as you start to develop this idea and you build this world around this idea, it becomes its own entity, it becomes its own thing. And that's where the fictionalized element comes in.
The stories I've worked on nearly always come from the scenarios around me or around the people I've worked with. We find that writing from that place brings a heck of a lot more truth and deeper storytelling because we're so familiar with the scenario. It's very easy to go, oh, here's a good idea, but that's pretty much where it sits because it's only coming from your imagination. Being able to fulfill in all the gaps either takes a hell of a lot of research or it takes drawing on your own experience for that. So with Awkward Love, that was an example. It was inspired by my now fiance's dating experiences before me. And because she'd lived those horrific experiences so much, the story wrote itself. And because they were from a place of honesty and real life experience, we also found that appealed to the audience because so many of them had been in the same scenario. We didn't have to make it up. It's something that many, many people had experienced.
How much truth should there be in fictional stories? That is a great question. And I'm going to say nothing and everything. You can make up entire scenarios, entire characters, it doesn't matter. But I think the heart of your story needs to be true. And it doesn't matter what your characters do. And it doesn't matter how your characters do it. They can be completely fictional in a fictional world with fictional animals and fictional food. It doesn't matter. But what you're really trying to do is connect to an audience, and the way you connect is speak to their heart. And those only come from a real truthful sense and feeling of what you really want to say, because what you really want to say isn't plot and it isn't your characters. It is the core of your story, and that is the only thing that really needs to be true.
I put a lot of truth into my stories, maybe too much. I have a habit of putting my whole self into it. I've used up a lot of my life and my family's life in my scripts. And I think you don't have to start from that place, but it gives it an authenticity. It gives your characters a detail because they're real people. And I think the emotional logic of it will be real because it is real. And I will often start with a story that is autobiographical, and knowing that it will evolve and change and become a story that belongs to someone else instead of me.
On a purely literal level, it's a fictional story, so there doesn't need to be any. But on a storytelling level, there absolutely does need to be a truth to the storytelling, to the intent of the storytelling. A story needs to be grounded, as I've spoken about before, a story needs to be grounded in a truth, in something that the viewer or the reader can grab hold of. Yeah, as an example, that movie Gravity, I have no connection whatsoever with being an astronaut or living in outer space, but that story was grounded in a very human journey. The adversity and the loneliness and the grief and the resilience, they're all very, very human, very relatable themes. And because that was the truth at the center of that film, I was able to go on that journey and completely connect to it in a really tangible way.
Particularly in genre film, the elements that I feel need to be realistic are a sense of character and what a character would react to. And then beyond that, often genre films are a parable of something real, and that's the way that they really connect in with an authentic tonal vibe is by having that sort of parable.
I think it's really important, and I don't think it's a question just for writers. I think it's really important for directors as well. You have to bring the story back to something that you understand, otherwise you can't tell it well enough.
I think when you are developing fiction, the way to ensure, or the way to try and nurture truth and authenticity within your story, is to really tap into the themes and how you interpret those themes. If you are trying to interpret those themes through the lens of someone else rather than yourself, then it's likely sometimes the characters might not seem authentic, might not seem believable. So it's really tapping into your own understanding of how a character's mind or inner workings work. It's also tapping into your understanding of these themes and how they play out in your world. Because if you can take that and then transplant your truth and your way of seeing that into that fictional world and the way characters relate to one another, the way that world works, hopefully other people will be able to see that truth as well and relate to something in that truth. And this is where having a universal theme is really, really important.
Stories are often about identity, and in Indigenous communities in particular, stories are not always about an individual. Stories are often about your whānau, your family, your village, your oere, your hapū, your tribe, your waka, your iwi. And as an Indigenous filmmaker, you are often considering, when writing a story or telling a story for the screen, the wider implications of what that story means for your identity as part of a collective. You also have responsibilities to your community.
about the story that you have told. Your family is going to be looking at that story and the wider community and asking what it says about you and about the people you're representing. As Indigenous storytellers, we are always representing our communities. And that is something that is inherently different, I believe, to most mainstream or non-Indigenous or non-people of colour storytellers.
In the same way that a writer needs to be interested and observant, it makes sense to apply the same approach when you're writing characters from different backgrounds to yourself. You've do your research, be respectful, you know, be interested, be observant, ask lots of questions. Talk to the right people, don't make assumptions. These are all common sense things that you should be doing if you are writing for characters who aren't from the same background as you. With every story, you're wanting to create characters who are both authentic but also wholly unique, and relying on stereotypes or only a vague knowledge of the background of this character obviously isn't a strong place to start from.
Representation is important and identity is complicated, and you can't just write whatever you want. I think it is scary to write a character that is not the same ethnicity or culture or gender or sexuality as you. And if that's scary, that's good, because you have a responsibility to get that character right, to make that a fully formed human being who is nuanced and authentic. And I think the way to do that is with consultation. I would always, always get consultation from someone who is that gender, that ethnicity, that culture, and meaningful consultation, and early and all the way through. Because the characters you write will be shaped by your own experiences. What you write will be shaped by your privilege and your place in society and the way you've been brought up. So you've got a big responsibility when you're writing characters that aren't like you.
What a writer should consider when they're writing about characters that are really different to them, cultures, genders, ethnicities, sexuality. First of all, is this your story to tell? Would be the first one. And really, really interrogate. If it's a story that's specific to a culture that you don't identify with, maybe really reconsider, or really, really ask yourself why you're telling this story. If you're telling a story that happens to have elements of other cultures, as they should, or other sexualities and genders, because representation matters, we can't all see just the same people on the screen, otherwise it would be so boring. Make sure that you have done your homework. Make sure that you have people on your team that you can talk to, that can input in a really meaningful way, that aren't just there to tick a box.
So if you are a storyteller writing about a character or a situation or a story outside your own character, your own community, you need to consider that very carefully. You need to ask yourself, why am I telling this story about this person? If the answer is, well, I think I'm going to get funding if I have a Māori girl in my film, you need to really check yourself. If you believe that there is a really good reason to tell this story, then I think you need to go and consult with members of that community. If you're writing about a young Asian man or a black woman, I think you should go and talk to an Asian man or a black woman and find out what they think about the story. I think it's important to ask, do I have the right to tell this story? What is my authority to tell this story? What are the wider implications for my telling this story? And what I often find is that people have not considered the implications of what that character may mean for a community. For example, if I decide that I'm going to tell a story about a Pacific Island man and I decide that he's going to be a gangster, a criminal, and a drug addict, then am I unwittingly feeding into stereotypes about those people? If I'm going to tell a story about an Asian woman, is she going to be a servant or somehow, a dragon lady? Am I feeding into stereotypes? And I think it's very difficult to understand the implication of a story type, a stereotype, if you are not from that culture.
I think when working, when trying to work with a character that's a specific ethnicity or diversity or sexual orientation, it's really good to consider if you're wanting to capture that community, that group, or is it a characteristic trait that you're actually trying to portray? Being Māori, I get approached with a lot of scripts by non-Māori people with Māori characters, and that's one of my first questions. Why are they Māori? A lot of the times I find it's actually a characteristic trait that they're trying to capture in their script. So it's something they identify with that group that they actually put in the script. And I think if it's a characteristic, then taking away that specific label actually opens you up to a lot more opportunities when it comes to casting. So I think trying to figure out if it's that characteristic or if it's the culture or the community you're trying to capture. If it is that culture or community, then I think it's really important to have someone in the team working with you, if you can't, that speaks to that group. To me, it just adds so much depth, and it's just really beautiful, some authenticity into your script that potentially you couldn't bring. So I think it's really important to ask yourself, like, are you the right person to tell this story if you aren't part of those groups? And when approaching someone to bring on that is a part of it, are they the right person? Another example is I get approached a lot about Māori culture content, but I actually didn't grow up in the culture. So although I am Māori, I may not be the right person for the idea. But in saying that, because I didn't grow up in the culture, I also bring a lot of understanding of what it means to not have that piece of culture. And that's another interesting layer. So I think it's really important to know exactly what you're wanting from that character.
My friend Victor Roger, who is a screenwriter and a playwright, often says, how would you feel about reading that story out to a community of the people you've written about? So you need to check yourself. We still live in an era where an awful lot of people have decided that it's okay for them to tell stories about people from other cultures. It's becoming more and more difficult to do that. And we see the hashtags by us and about us, which are about representation. We see the hashtags representation matters. Those are all around authenticity and one's own authority to tell a story from other cultures.
The homework for this video tutorial is to jot down three story ideas. Going off gut instinct, write a paragraph on each. Include a beginning, middle, and end if you can. Ask yourself, who is the main character and what do they want? There is absolutely no right or wrong answer. This is a chance for you to dig into your creative instincts, think about what's important to you, what you want to say, and to have fun.